You are now listening to Might Works Radio. Listen to Holy Spirit talk to you. Here's your host, Evangelist King.
Praise the living God, dear heart. Thank you for joining me again today on Holy Spirit Talk, Shalom Prayer. Today, dear heart, our prayer point is entitled, His Logo Over Us is Love. You know, the children's might, we have our own logo. And a logo, it really symbolizes ownership. It's a signification, it's a description to let the people or person know who that company or organization is. You know, when you see their logo, you automatically know who they are and what they're all about. So Jesus Christ's logo, his signification, his description over us, dear heart, is love. Now remember that our Lord and Master, Jesus Christ, do not have love. He is love. That's who he is. He is love. So therefore, we, his children, born and birthed into the family of God by the Holy Spirit, we too is his banner. We are his signification. We too is love. That's the reason why whatever we do, it always ends up in love towards the individual. Now, we know who the one who's not of love, because he cannot love because love is not of him. That is the evil one. That is Satan. But Jesus Christ himself is love. So his banner, as the scriptures say, over us is love. And that's what a banner is. It's nothing but a logo. It's a signification, it's a description. It shows proof of ownership. You know, when we see McDonald's logo, we automatically know, oh, that's McDonald's. Well, how a person know that you are of God is doing by love. It's love, because whatever we do, it signifies or describes, or the description stem from love. So remember that Jesus' logo or banner over us is love. Today, our scripture reference is coming from Psalms 138. Now, I'm one of those where I cannot speak to you unless I bring the word of God, because it's only the word of God that is truth. If I don't have in the word, which is the word of God, then I have nothing to say. So regardless of whatever we do, it always consists of God's word. And remember now, who is the living word? Jesus Christ is the living word. So everything we read about in the written word is just a logo, a banner, or signification of Jesus Christ, who is love. Don't have love, he is love. Again, there's a difference. When you have something, you're really saying that's not really part of you. You just have it. But love is actually Jesus. That's how he is. He's love. He's love, dear heart. So, you know, there's a song that goes, I have nothing but love for you, baby. No, only Jesus Christ have nothing but love, because he is love. And the only way we can love ye one another is that we first must receive the one who is love, who is Jesus Christ. So he wants to encourage us today that his logo, his banner is over us. And it's love, because he is love. He loves us. You know, he really cares for us. The enemy always try to get us to fall out with our Lord and Savior, to falsely accuse him that he doesn't care for us. Dear heart, that is a lie of the enemy. That's a lot of enemy. And the enemy does that so you keep your focus on him anyway. Always keep your focus on what the devil is doing. That's what the enemy wants to do. Because remember, faith comes by hearing. And hearing, faith comes. So whether you're hearing the word of God or whether you're hearing the words of the evil one, you are receiving faith and trust. So whatever you're hearing, that is what you're beginning to trust. So if you're hearing more about what the devil is doing in your life, if you're talking more about what the devil is doing in your life, guess what, dear heart? That's where your trust and your faith will lie in, because of the words that's coming out your mouth. You always bring an attention to what the devil is doing in your life. Dear Heart, we be honest with you, we really don't have time, much time on this earth to be talking about what the devil is doing in our life. I find that 9 out of 10, when people are always talking about what the devil is doing in their life, it's due to or stem from them giving the devil space in their life to do something. See, Dear Hope, remember, his logo, his banner over us is love. His desire is that we prosper in every area. He told us what we should or shouldn't do. He done told us. That's all Jesus can do is tell us. He's so loving and gracious when he gave us this will, this way in which we can choose to go. He left it there. He said, now you too. He said, I can force you if I want to. He said, I don't want service in whom that I force to serve me. He said, whosoever will, let him come to me. Come to me freely. Accept what I have already done for you freely. See, that's the love and mercy and grace of our Heavenly Father. He let us choose which way we're going to go. Then he go ahead and tell us to warn us what happens when we don't choose him. You know, because whenever we don't choose him, the devil is happy because he know he can inflict a lot of unnecessary suffering and pain upon us because we belongs to him when we reject the Lord's commands, you see. But Jesus, so gracious and merciful, he gave us a way out. The Father gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believe in him, Jesus Christ, should not die. Spiritually, you will not die. You will live forever with him. Live with him and live on not this earth here. This earth can be done away with. It's going to be a new heaven, a new earth. And we will be living the way the Father has originally intended for us to live, where it would be pure joy, peace, and happiness. It would be no such thing even as tears. Tears would be never known of, really, because of the joy, peace, and happiness, because of love, because of Jesus Christ's presence would be with us and we with him always. Dear Heart, ain't you looking forward to that time? But until then, dear Heart, until then, our master told us what we need to do to bring glory to his name on this earth, because there's many who are in the kingdom of darkness who have refused his logo, who have refused his banner, who have refused him because he is love. The Father is so merciful and gracious unto us that he's long-suffering. And the reason why he's long-suffering is because he's given those a chance who rejected his Son. He's given them a chance to repent and come unto him. That's the reason why when we really, truly understand the will of the Father, you wouldn't be saying, I'd be so glad when Jesus come back here. You wouldn't say that, Dear Heart. Because his will is for no man to perish. And he has lengthened his stay because he's given those a chance who have not received his Son, Jesus, to receive him and to come unto him. So in the meantime, Dear Heart, we need to realize his logo, his banner over us is love. In the meantime, we need to learn not to focus on what the devil is doing. When we focus on what the devil is doing, Dear Heart, we will have sorrow, pain, and unhappiness. That's what we will have, because that's who he is. So focus on the Lord. Give praise and all thanks and glory to him. Why do you think King David was so close to the Lord? Why do you think the Lord said, David's a man after my own heart? Because Jesus said, my heart is to do the will of my Heavenly Father. My heart, when I was on earth, is not to do what I wanted to do. I didn't focus on my feelings. I didn't focus on my aim, my desire. I focus on him who sent me. Dear Heart, this is what David did. Our lesson, again, coming from Psalm 138. Chapter, and I'm reading from the Complete Jewish Bible. This is what King David did, Dear Heart. He focused on Jesus Christ. He magnified him. He worshiped him. If only if only we'll learn to do this in the midst of the storm, in the midst of the persecution, in the midst of the problems, in the midst of the troubles, in the midst of the sickness and the pain, if we would just focus all our heart, soul, mind, strength, will, body on Him and giving Him thanks and glory for who He is, dear heart. Satan cannot hang on to your body. He cannot hang on to your mind. He cannot hang on to your will. He cannot hang on to your emotion. He got to let go. Only if we would do that, dear heart. Only if we would realize the banner, the signification, the description, the mark that He placed upon us, who is Himself, who is love, and we focus on Him and just give Him all the praise, glory, and honor in spite of. Dear heart, when we choose to do that, we are more than a conqueror. We are walking in our victory. We won't go around saying, I'm seeking victory. No, we are in our victory. But our problem is we're looking too much on the natural, what we don't have, what we do have. Looking at the Joneses and the Coxes and the Foxes over there, you know, comparing ourselves to them. We're looking at Brother John, Sister Marie, who seems to be more spiritual than I am. If only I were like them, I think I'd be all right. Oh, no, dear heart, no. Sister Marie and Brother John have to do the same thing as you, have to keep their affection and mind on the Lord, have to give Him the glory in spite of their problems, in spite of their troubles. Praise the living God. You know, I thank the Lord for Himself, most of all, but I also thank Him for His servants, in which He given us many examples in His written word of those who kept their affections in spite of the problems and the trouble, stayed on Him. They kept looking at the logo, the banner that was placed over them, who is love, who is Jesus Christ. They kept their eyes on that banner. They kept their eyes on that logo, and they said, that's Jesus, who is love. Praise the living God. You know, King David says in Psalms 138, he said, I give you thanks with all my heart, not to idols, but to you I sing praise. Oh, Lord, Father, God, in the name of Jesus, if we can only learn to do that, stop talking about your problem, stop talking about your trouble, stop talking about what the devil is doing. You know, for those of you who are married, how will you feel if your husband comes to you or your wife comes to you, always talking about a former boyfriend, former girlfriend, and there you are, their current spouse, but they're talking about that former boyfriend, that former girlfriend. How would that make you feel? Wouldn't make you feel good, would it? Do you not know we talk about, most of us talk about our former boyfriend more so than we talk about our current husband, and I'm talking about spiritually. When we talk about our former boyfriend, who is Satan, more than we talk about our current husband, who is Jesus Christ, that don't make Jesus feel good. He said, I'm a jealous God. You should not have another God before me. Now, whether you consider Satan to be your God or not, but according to the word of God, that is your God, because that's who you're talking about the most. So David here, in spite of the problem he was going through, they was going through something. Even the young boy he was going through, he had all these nice older brothers who seemed to be more built bodily, in bodily form, more built than him and more prestigious looking than him. And it seemed to be they was his father's favorite, and he was the least of his father. So the father took him away behind the sheep and taking care of the sheep, and he was bragging on his bigger brother. Can you imagine how that make a little teenage boy feel? But lo and behold, the banner over David is love, was love, Jesus Christ. In spite of that, the Lord used that occasion in David's life to draw him closer to himself. So dear David realized, the little young boy, that his banner over me is love. God, you love me, and I love you. I would give you praise. I would give you thanks with all my heart. I would magnify you with all my heart, not to any idol, I'm not going to magnify how my father is treating me in comparison to my brothers. I'm not going to do that, because if I did that, then they are my God, they are my idol. Because who I idolize is who I'm going to talk about. Jesus, I idolize you. If I choose to have an idol, Jesus, it'll be you. Praise the living God. He said, and I will sing praise to you. Praise of thanksgiving. Doesn't matter how I sounded. Because, you know, scripture really don't tell us how David sound. But scripture did tell us that David played an instrument. And you see, people can play instruments, but they really cannot sing. So we don't know David, King David, could sing or not, but we knew he could play the instrument. He was anointed in playing the instrument. No, we can't say he was anointed to be a singer. No, we do know he was anointed to play the instrument because of how them devils tormented King Saul. And King Saul called him the musician to play. So just like David, no, we might not can sing, but sing to him anyway. Because actually, God never look at the tune that comes from your mouth anyway. He looks at the tune that comes from your heart. You make music from your heart, not from your mouth. So David was making music from his heart, dear heart. And God was bashing in his music. And the presence of Almighty came upon David one time. David, little tiny screaming little David, killed a lion and killed a bear. And it was not a cub. This was a grown lion, a grown bear. That's because of the presence of God. See, dear heart, that's what happens when you magnify him in the midst of your problem. The anointing of God will come upon you, and the anointing of God will slay your giants. That is how you get, how you slay your giants. Your giants are these spiritual, wicked demons, especially those strongholds. You slay them giants by praising and magnifying the Lord, exalting him, idolizing him, magnifying him. And by doing that, the Holy Spirit will come upon you and he will slay those giants that are coming against you in your life. Verse 2. David continue here to say to the Lord, and we need to start saying unto the Lord. Start saying unto people. Start telling people your problem. Tell Jesus. Have a little talk with him. As a little girl, even little children have problems, where you think they have problems or not. The devil don't give nobody a break. Don't matter about your age. And I was a little girl. I was going through some things. I went through a lot of rejection. There was no father figure in my life. All the male figures seemed to reject me, and I never had a father. And as a little girl, now I know the Lord just talked to me all the time. He's the one who told me that I have a big brother and I have a father who loved me very much. And that's how I found out about the Lord when I was a little girl. Now, none of my parents or the grown-ups that I around were Christian. Jesus made himself known to me as a little girl. You know, I didn't share the conversation with nobody because I was so at peace. You know, when Jesus talked to you, you are at peace. Even a little girl, when he spoke to me, I was at peace. And he just tell me all the time, you have a father. And I would say, I have a father, I do. He said, yes, and he loves you very much. Your father's in heaven. He loves you. And you have a big brother, because I always wanted a big brother. I said, I do? Yeah, his name is Jesus. Now, I never heard of Jesus before. Parents didn't take me to church to learn about Jesus, but this voice said, I had a big brother who loved me very much. His name is Jesus. So I was happy. I was happy. So anyway, as a little girl, and I would go through problems, and there was a song. So my mother, my grandmother finally started going to church with this song that the old women at church used to sing, Have a Little Talk with Jesus. And I fell in love with that song. So I will, as a little girl, just walk around the house and I have a problem, I would sing that song. Didn't care about how I sounded because I knew to Jesus Christ, I sounded good because it come from my heart. And I would sing that song, Have a Little Talk with Jesus. Tell him all about your trouble. And he would listen by and by. Dear heart, that song would bring me great encouragement because I kept singing that song. Again, I didn't tell my mother, tell anybody the things I'm going through because at that time, you know, there was nobody to tell. But I would sing that song. And after I would sing that song, I feel so much better. And I would just go outside and play and just everything was fine. You know, I would even see devils and different grown people looking at me. And I knew it was the devil. Of course, I didn't know that his name. I'd call them things because they was evil. But the Lord kept me, and I knew he had angels because I talked with my angel that was there. Didn't understand. Now I knew it was my guardian angel, you know. But I was happy. I was happy. And I knew that my big brother, my father, Heavenly Father, was taking care of me. And I had this man, even though he was an angel, but a little girl, I said it was a man there protecting me. And I wasn't afraid, and I was just walking around and playing around, happy, happy, in the midst of witchcraft workers. But, dear heart, in the midst of your giants, in the midst of your problems, in the midst of your trouble, remember you have a logo, a banner over you with Jesus Christ. He is love. He will take care of you, but you got to magnify him. You got to trust him. Trust him. Keep your eyes, your mind, your affection, stayed on him. Now, stayed on him, that means something's going to try to come to get you to leave him. But it's up to you to keep yourself stayed in him, to stay in him. Now, I have seen over the years and have learned Jesus would definitely would never leave us, never forsake us. He would never do that. But that's not the issue. That's never a problem. The issue and the problem is we leave him. We forsake him. Just like you as a parent, when you out and about, you have your little small child, and they toddler age, they're walking, there's just no way you will never leave your child. You will never turn their hands loose. You will never. Why? Because your banner, your logo over them is love. And you hold on to them. Tight. You would never do that. But you remember now, they too got to be hold on. Because if you hold on to them and they don't hold on, you'll be dragging them and you will harm them. But they got to hold on. So you hold on to them. So again, you will never turn them loose. You will never leave them or forsake them. But they decide to turn you loose. And when they turn you loose and run, then that's where the problem start. And that's where some predator would try to snatch and grab your child. Well, that's what happens to us, dear heart, when we fail to keep our affection stayed on him. And especially in the way that we should, that we do that the most is to get into his word. Let your hand, nowadays, we must say this now because of the internet. Nowadays, we got to handle the word for ourselves. Handle the word with your own hand for yourself. That means get the Holy Bible with your own hands and handle it. Turn the computer off. Now, it's good. There's a time for that. But you don't let that primarily be how you handle the word of God. You need to turn it off because a lot of times a distraction will come in. You'll be tempted to go browse other sites or whatever. So just turn off that computer. Go grab the written word of God, the Holy Bible. Handle it with your own hands. And you meditate, read, and study upon it. Just meditate upon what you read. Take your time and meditate. Now, the devil say, well, I ain't got time to do that. Well, if you ain't got time to do that, dear heart, that's why come you're talking about more about what the devil is doing in your life than what Jesus is doing. That's why. Because you have to make time. Whatever you really want to do, you do it. Now, I have learned this and seen it as well. Whatever we want to do, dear heart, we do it. I know I'm like that. If I truly want to do something, ain't nothing going to stop me. I'm going to do it. And you are like that, too. So if you really want to handle the Word of God for yourself, to study and meditate upon it, because when you handle the Word of God with your own hand, the contents of the written manual, with your own hands, and you in your mind get into the Word of God, and you dwell upon and you meditate upon, you are beginning to become more familiar in who love is, who Jesus is. You'll become to be more familiar with the logo over you, who is love. You will, dear heart, and therefore, your trust in him will be deepened, strengthened, and deepened. It will get deeply rooted in your heart. Now, I remember as a little young girl when I started reading the Bible. I would just read it, and I could memorize. And I was younger then. I could memorize stuff much better and quicker, and I was good at it. And one day, this voice said, Terry, it's good that you're memorizing my word. He said, but it needs to become a part of who you are. It got to get deep down in your heart. Because if it don't get deep down in your heart, the devil can come and do away with that, with what you're learning. And I said, Lord, how can that happen? He said, just stay in my word and trust me. And as you grow older, he said, there's certain experiences, and he told me, he said, these are spiritual experiences, Terry, that I'm going to cause to come to happen in your life. And as you overcome these spiritual experiences, he said, my word will sink deeper down in your heart. So it's going to come with time and in time. Now, that's what Lord told me as a little young girl. So now being a much, much, much older woman now, I see that is correct. That is correct. Because then when I learned the Word of God was on the surface. You see, anytime something's on the surface, Satan can either blow a wind and just wash it away. But when it's deeply rooted, it's hard to uproot it. He told me, he said, I will establish you, Terry, in my word. That's what he told me as a little young girl. And dear, I'm telling you, now I don't share my testimony, but from that point to now, right in the middle of my life, I've been through some things. If I had to do all over again, I would not want to go through it. But I thank God that I went through those things because it helped me in my trust in him. It deepened my trust in my heart towards him. You know, it's like when you plant something in the ground, you can plant on the surface, and if you plant on the surface, you can either pull it out. But if you plant it deep, and as long as it stay planted deep, those roots will grow all over the place. So therefore, it's not as easy to pull that plant out of that ground because of the roots have been grounded for so long and sunk deeper into the ground is very hard. Well, that's how it is with God's word. That's how it is with the word of the Lord. It takes time. So that's the reason why we need to learn to spend time with the Lord, to meditate upon him, so that his word can sink deeper and deeper and deeper down into the soil of our heart. So that when trials and tests, which are the winds of the evil one, when they blow, when they rage, it's not going to affect you because the word of God is so deeply rooted down in you. But before that could happen, dear heart, we got to handle the word with our own hand. You know, again, there's a time for the internet and there's a time not for the internet. Just turn it off. so that you can keep your focus solely on the Word of God. Also, King David said in verse 2, he said, I bow down toward your holy temple and give thanks to your name for your grace and truth. You see, David, instead of magnifying his problems, again, I just want you to remember David's situation here. David was anointed by God's chosen prophet Samuel to become king of Israel. Okay? But at that particular moment, there was already a king, King Saul. It wasn't David's time yet. So that tells you and me there's a time for all things. There's a time for us, you know. Some of you decide to be in full-time ministry. There's a time. Just because people told you, God call you to ministry. You got a call on your life. David, too, had a call in his life, but there's a time. Even Jesus had a call in his life, but there was a time the Father had set for him to begin or start his ministry, which was from the time he was born, was 30 years, you see? So there's a time for David to become king. So that promise was there, and that promise was sure. But David went through hell, dear heart. Here's a man who other men follow him in hopes that he will become king, and they knew he was appointed, chosen, anointed by God to be king. But at the present moment, his circumstances looked like that wasn't true. He was living in cold, damp cave. He was living in caves. I don't know for how long, but it was a long time David was living in those caves and those men's with him. But yet still he was God's anointed, God's chosen and appointed. Don't you know there was men that followed David that said, well, if you were God's chosen, anointed, appointed king, why are you living in this cave? Why is God treating you this way and causing you or allowing you to be in this cave? David didn't focus on word because he knew those words was not stem or was not coming through the Holy Spirit through those men. It was the evil one trying to get David to doubt the Lord's doing, you see. Same thing with us, dear heart. When our natural circumstances are not going the way that we feel they should go because, after all, we are God's child, we have to be very careful of Satan through other people accusing the Lord to us that he's not faithful to us. Now, no, we don't call ourselves meaning to say something like that, or we'll say, well, I never say that. No, it's never in what you say. It's in what you do. It's in what you do, okay? So if we sit there and start bashing in self-sovereign pity in that, wondering, you know, why the devil having such a field day with me, always talking about what the devil's doing in our lives, then we are doing exactly that, dear heart. We are giving in to the accusation of the enemy and accusing God of being unfaithful to us. When we should keep our affection and mind stayed on him and give him thanks in spite of our circumstance, we need to give him thanks, just like King David. David said, I bow down toward your holy temple. I worship you and give thanks to your name for your grace and mercy, for your grace and truth. Now, David knew what God's holy temple was at that moment in Jerusalem. He was in that cave, so he said, I'm going to look to the direction of your holy temple, and I'm bowing down. But he was in a cave. Behold, we can learn from David. The Lord said, David's a man after his own heart, because this is what our Lord and Savior did when he walked the earth, and this is what we have to do. In spite of our problems and troubles, we need to just bow down to him where we are and just worship him in spite of. Give him praise and glory for his grace and for his truth. He said, for you have made your word even greater than the whole of your reputation. See, David trusted in God's word. David knew what the Lord told him. David knew the Lord said, I have chosen you to be king over Israel. That's all that mattered to David. The circumstances did not matter. Even when sometimes Satan did get David to kind of get off course and think about his natural circumstance, David realized, oh, no, that's wrong. He jumped right back on the right track. He didn't stay there, dear. He went back. He suddenly went back onto the right track and giving God praise and glory. So David said, I praise you, I magnify you, for you have made your word even greater than the whole of your reputation. When I call, you answer me, you made me bold and strong. David said, when I call, when we call upon the Lord, dear heart, from our heart, he hears us, he will answer us, and he will make us bold and strong. He gives us his strength. And by the way, it's good to be weak. I know the Lord told me that many years ago. Many years ago, you know, and after the Lord brought this to me, I said, Lord, you are right. I couldn't do nothing but say, Lord, you are right. You know, we had small children, and my husband wasn't making the income as he could to help, you know, support the family. And I mean, it was just a lot of problems. You know, we didn't have our own place to stay. We were living in there with my parents. And you know, it just wasn't a good situation. But I had those little children, so finally I got a job, and it was hard. But I noticed that around my children, you know, I just didn't want them to see that mom was having such a hard time. So I just act strong. I would just act strong around my children. Just would act strong, you know. That's why come today, they never knew that we had such a hard time as a little young girl, little young children. But now since they grown and look back, they were like, oh, mama, we see what was happening. I said, yep. I said, thank God that he didn't let y'all sit when y'all were small. But they had them little steps a good time. They didn't even know they were poor, riding bicycles without no tires, just riding on the rim of a bicycle. But to them, if we looked at those girls, they're riding those bicycles without no rim, you would say, what's wrong with them crazy little girls? They act like there's tires on those bicycles. But that was the grace of God. That's just one example of what we were going through. And anyway, you know, I just acted strong, you know, like a strong mother should act. But on the inside, I was so exhausted. I was so tired. But the good thing about it, I didn't tell people. I really didn't, because I knew those people was not my friends. Matter of fact, majority of them, that's what they was desiring for us to not to have nothing, for us to be living in poverty like that, for us not to, you know, be healthy in the things of God, spiritually nor physically. So I knew they wasn't friends. And when I say friends, I'm talking about mainly, I'm talking about family members at that. So one day, you know, I was so tired and exhausted, this voice said, Terry. And it said it so lovely and sweet and kind. All I could do was just cry and say, yes, Lord. This voice said, Terry, it's okay to be weak. When that voice said that, I bust out crying. Nobody was there with me. I bust out crying. Dear heart, tears came down my face. I mean, oh, I can't describe how I felt, because that voice was so kind, so sweet. And he said, it's okay to be weak. Oh, girl. And I said, oh, girl, like I'm Pacific talking to a woman. Maybe the Holy Spirit talking to you. Because I said, oh, girl. And I know there's men and women, but there's a particular woman. You're going through this. And I guess that's why the Holy Spirit had me to say, oh, girl. And that's what I used to say if I'm personally talking to someone, especially if it's a female, I say, and I'm telling them something, I say, oh, girl. So, yeah, God talking to you, woman of God. It's okay. It's okay to be weak. Because the Lord said, Terry, my strength is made perfect in your weakness. I'm telling you, I bust out crying with joy. Those tears was of joy to hear those words, because I thought I had to be a strong mother for my children. But the Lord told me, Terry, it's okay to be weak, because my strength is made perfect in your weakness. So his logo, his banner over us is love, dear heart. If you understand my voice and you feel weak today, you say amen, because his strength is only made perfect in our weakness. If you consider yourself strong, then God said, okay, you don't need my help, because only my strength is made perfect in your weakness. So praise the Lord when you feel weak. Keep feeling weak, because you know your strength is in him. He's your strength. He's your enabler by his Holy Spirit. Praise the living God. And this is what David was saying. When I called, you answered me. You made me bold and strong because you gave me your strength during my weakness. He says in verse 4, all the kings of the earth will thank you, Adonai, when they hear the words you have spoken. Don't you know when God speaks, when God speaks through his chosen servant, dear heart, he knows the right things to say. And when he say it, it gives you such love and peace and comfort. Why? Because, again, his banner, his logo over us is love. He's love. That's who he is. He's love. Now, remember now, he's love. And love only corrects or chastens those whom he loves. So, Jesus always going to bring correction to us because he loves us. So remember, when he correct us, it's because he loves us. Now, if Jesus not correcting you, that means he don't love you. So you thank God for his correction, because he said, I correct, I chasten those whom I love, who I love. Why? Because we love him. Because everybody don't love him. Everybody. There are some people who have willfully chosen not to love him, not to serve him, not to receive him, okay? Just like with us in the natural, if someone willfully refuses to have anything to do with us, then there's nothing we can do. We just leave them alone. We just leave them alone. Verse 5, he said, they will sing about Adonai's ways. Great is the glory of Adonai. You see, give him the praise. Great is the glory of the Lord. See, magnify the Lord with all your heart. For though Adonai is high and lifted up, he cares for the lowly, while the proud he perceives from afar. So those who reject him, they are proud. They're prideful. They say they don't need the Lord. So he's really far away from them. Why? Because really they are far away from him. But you know what? Our Lord is still so loving and gracious. Even when they have chosen and realized that they need him, and repent of their sins and turn from their wicked way, Jesus said, call upon me and I will answer you. He's such a loving and forgiving God. You see, dear, we serve a mighty God who deserves all praise and glory. When things are going well with us, when things are not going well with us, he still deserves the praise and the glory. Praise the living God. King David continued to say in verse 7, you keep me alive when surrounded by danger. You put out your hand when my enemy raves. With your right hand, you save me. Dear heart, Jesus actually saves us more than we realize. I'm telling you, more than we realize. Now, we only can see as far what our eyes allow us to see. But we know there's a spiritual battle going on in the spirit realm. And Jesus saves us. He surrounds us. He has set his armies around us in protecting us from his enemies who are our enemies. That's why we should never stop praising him. Don't you know, if Satan really had the right to do what he really wanted to do, you know what, dear heart? Satan won't kill us, but he will bring so much destruction and torment upon us so that we can suffer, so that we can suffer and be in pain, be in misery continuously. That's what Satan's desire is to do to human beings. But because of the mercy and graciousness of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and who he is, because he is love, he say, no, no, my blood protects them. My blood saves them. My blood justifies them. My blood have ransomed them. My blood have bought them. I have applied my blood to them. I have credited them with my right standing with my Father. So therefore, back off. Dear Lord, that's why we should just praise him and thank him because of who he is and what he is to us and just how he always takes care of us, how he put his hand in protecting our enemy who is raging against us, who he surrounds us with his love, blocking off the enemy when he has or is trying to bring danger into our lives. We should praise him in spite of. We should show him that in spite of what our natural circumstances are, he's worthy in receiving all praise, all glory, and all honor. Lord, we praise you when things are going well, and we continue to praise you when things are not going so well. At least not looking like they are. But in the spirit, we know they are. In either way, we praise him. Verse 8, Adonai will fulfill his purpose for me. See, he has a purpose for each and every one of us who have chosen him. And he will fulfill his purpose. He's the author of our faith. He started it. He's the finisher. He's going to end it. Praise the living God. We just don't know that in between work and how he does it. But all that matter is we know the beginning and we know the end. So we're going to dwell on the end. That he started this good work in us, he's going to complete it. He said, your grace, Adonai, continues forever. Don't abandon the work of your hand. Jesus Christ does not abandon the work of his hand. He will not abandon you, dear heart. So therefore, you do not abandon him. And remember, from this day forth, that his banner, his logo over you and I is love. Magnify him. Exalt his mighty name forever. When you're around your house, when you're out in the marketplace, don't matter where you are, on your job, you sing praises and hymns to him and glorify and magnifying him in spite of, okay? As you do that, he said, my strength is made perfect in your weakness. Then you will feel within yourself the joy of the Lord, the peace of the Lord, because Jesus is peace, you see. You will have that inner joy, that inner peace, okay? So that's all you need to do. All you need to do is start magnifying what the devil is doing in your life, in your family, but magnify Jesus Christ. Exalt his name forever. Give him thanksgiving. Give him praise wherever you go, okay, and whatever you do. So, dear Hoy, again, thank you for tuning in to today's broadcast on Mike Works Radio, Holy Spirit Talk, Shalom Prayer. I'm your host, Evangelist King. Be sure to tune in. Again, we come on live on our radio program, Mike Works Radio, every Monday and Friday, 12 noon Eastern Standard Time. You can either go on the internet and you can go to our website at thechildrensmike.org and click on Mike Works Radio there. Or for those of you who's not on the internet, you can always tune in. Only during the live broadcast time, Monday and Friday, 12 noon Eastern Standard Time, by dialing 347-539-5174. So, dear heart, check us out on the website, thechildrensmike.org, and look at the many programs that the Lord has blessed us to have over the years. And our aim is to bring glory to his mighty name. Okay, so remember always that his logo over us is love, and in your getting, be sure you get understanding. Shalom.